So we'd like to call you to worship this morning and welcome you to First Baptist Church. Will you stand? The heavens are telling the glory of God.
May our worship reflect God's glory.
The firmament proclaims God's handiwork.
May we see each other as the handiwork of God.
Let our prayer and praise, our singing and proclamation project the love of God.
Let us worship together.
Lord God, we come before you this morning with thankful hearts because we are in your house, praising you, lifting up your name, thanking you, and giving you the credit that you deserve for being our Creator God. So we thank you for the opportunity to worship in a free land. We thank you, Lord, for each one who has come out on this cold morning. We ask that you would bless them. Also, we lift up those who could not be here with us this morning, for there are many. And we ask that you bless them as well. Perhaps they are watching on the YouTube, or perhaps that they'll tune in later. But whatever it might be, we ask that you bless them during this time together. Now be with us as we worship, be with us as we fellowship, guide, direct, protect us, keep us in your loving care. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Remain standing, if you would, for our praise songs. Marianne's going to help us out this morning.
Okay, y'all ready to sing? All right.
I'm running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Love, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for the day till I am a soul on fire. Till I am a soul on fire.
Everybody sing it loud and beautiful. God, I'm running for your heart.
I'm running for your heart till I am
Good singing, thank you. This is the air I breathe.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. You're the holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread.
This morning especially, I want to lift up those who are traveling. And on that note, Lori Stoker, our office administrator, secretary, is traveling this week along with Sharon Rozier. And so that's a twofold prayer request. Pray for their safety as they travel. And pray for me that I don't do something to the copy machine that can't be fixed and Lori gets back. Because I'm generally not allowed to touch that piece of equipment without supervision. A lot of buttons on there. In all seriousness, though, the office will be closed most of the week. I'll be around, but you know the more easy way to get a hold of me is on the bottom of your bulletin is my cell phone number and my email address. I think Cheryl Wolf and Mary Ann Simpson are going to check the answering machine and email in the office from time to time. But if you have a question and need an answer quickly this week, just call Mary Ann or call me directly, and we'll do what we can to help. Lori will be back next week. Let's go now to our time of prayer. Eternal God, you are the maker of us all. We are all your creation, people formed in your image as individuals and here as a community, formed and fed and nourished with some understanding of who you are. We worship you today in recognition of your calling, of your communicating, your caring to invite us to share in your creative and healing work. We are here today because we have heard you speak. We have heard you call ourselves to you. Help us, Lord, to respond to you when you call. Help us to respond to your invitation. God, of all of our moments, of all of our days and our nights, of the months and the seasons of our lives, you speak and you act in the world around us. not only to call all people to you, but also to direct and guide us in the way of healing and wholeness. Today, Lord, I pray that you awaken us. Awaken us to hear what you would say to us. Help us to open our ears and our eyes and our hearts to your presence. Help us to know when it's your voice we are hearing and when it's just our own ideas or desires getting in the way. Lord, we pray that your church may rise up with renewed commitment and answer of your call. We pray that your people may be instruments of your grace and love. We pray for those who consider themselves inadequate to do your work, people who dismiss or avoid your call in their lives. Give them a new vision and the confidence that you are their strength and their hope. We pray for those who, in answering your call, must leave the known for the unknown, who must leave the oasis for the desert, the comfortable for the uncertain. Give them courage and steadfast faith. We pray too, Lord, for those who are in want and need, for those of us and of the larger community around us who suffer in some way, in body or in soul. We remember before you those names that are printed on our prayer list. We do pray for those who are sick or ill, for those who are recovering from medical procedures, for those who are lonely during these cold winter months. Lord, hear our prayers. Loving Father, bless us with an abundant faith, a fruitful ministry, and a joyful life. Bless us and all those who gather here today that we might continue the work of Jesus who came to heal, to save, and to deliver us all, and who taught us to pray as one family by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our offering sentence today comes from the book of Revelation, from the fourth chapter of Revelation. O Lord, our God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power, because you have created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. If the ushers would come forward to gather today's gifts and offerings. Continue to grow your presence in our lives and all over the earth. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
In reading the scripture today, I'm reminded of a special time that we've been having on Wednesday evenings at our midweek Bible study. Pastor has been leading that study, and I would encourage you to come out at 6:30 on Wednesday evenings to share with those of us who get together. One of the things, Pastor, if I have this correct, Wednesday evening is kind of a prelude to some of the things you'll be sharing on Sunday morning. So that's pretty neat to be able to not only read some of the passages, but to get some insight on what's happening on Sunday morning. I might direct you to the Psalms. Psalms chapter 19 is our Old Testament reading. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words, their voice is not heard. Yet their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In the heavens, he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom from the wedding canopy, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heart. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous together. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them there is great reward. But who can detect their errors? Clear me from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. And from the Old Testament, we read from Luke 4, verses 14 through 21, Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed upon him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." May God add his blessing to the reading of this, his holy word.
Mistake, and they got a bunch of people mad at them for this mistake. You remember what the mistake was? You remember? They gave people a drink that made them have to go to the bathroom. Yeah, I wondered if we remembered that. That's the kind of thing you would remember, I think. Let's find out if they have gotten over this, if they've had a better week. Malachi, Homer, are you guys here today?
Good morning, everyone.
Shalom, kids. Pastor Rob, what are you doing here today?
Well, Miss Brenda is out of town. She'll be out of town the next couple of weeks, so I'm taking her place. You're stuck with me.
That's good, because we both really need some pastorally advice right now.
Well, I'm happy to help. What can I do for you?
Well, the kids at school are still giving me an attitude about that Metamucil mix-up thing last week. Everybody's teasing me, and they even got a new nickname for me. Homer the Fiber Friend.
Yeah, and word of that incident spread around town, and now no one will take me seriously. I tried to join a new men's Bible study this week, and as soon as I introduced myself, someone said, "Oh, that's right, you're Malachi, the Metamucil guy." After that, they didn't listen to a word I said. All my pearls of wisdom fell on deaf ears. Even my own wife won't let this go. Every morning this week, Lillian asks, "What do you want for breakfast? Eggs or high-fiber cereal?" Then she laughs until she keels over, and I end up having to make my own breakfast.
Well, I am sorry to hear that that's happening to both of you.
So are we. So how do we fix this?
Yeah. How do we make everyone stop teasing us and be nice to us again? You know, the way the people of Nazareth were to Jesus in that Bible passage that Adrian just read.
Well, it's true in the passage Adrian just read that the Nazarenes, they were friendly to Jesus at first, but even he had some trouble getting people to take him seriously after a while. That's what we're going to be talking about next Sunday.
Next Sunday? But we need help now. I don't want to be teased at school all week again.
Right, and I don't want to be teased at home either.
Okay, so here's what you fellows need to do. First, just be honest. Admit to everyone that you made a mistake. Apologize for it, own it, say, "I'm sorry, I messed up." And then just go back to being a follower of Christ, acting the way that Jesus would want you to act. And don't let their teasing get to you. Just focus on the way Jesus teaches us to live.
And you think that's going to do it? I mean, you make people treat us with respect again?
Eventually, I do, yeah. The Bible tells us it will. You have to earn people's respect by behaving the way God wants us to behave. In James chapter 3, verse 13, it says, "If you are wise and understand God's ways, prove it by living an honorable life, doing good works with the humility that comes from God's wisdom."
So you're saying that the Bible says, if I want people to treat me with respect and think I'm wise, I have to prove it by the things I do, huh?
Yes, That's exactly right.
That might be a tall order.
Yes, especially for you, Malachi.
Hey, wait a minute. I don't do the wrong thing on purpose, you know.
That's true, Malachi. I know that. But you do have a history of doing some goofy things unintentionally.
Say, I've got an idea. Let's change your nickname to Malachi the Unintentional Goofball.
No, thanks. I'll just stick with Malachi the Bible Guy, if you don't mind.
That's fine, Malachi, but you've got to be sure to earn that title every single day in everything you do, just like that passage we read from James.
And what if I unintentionally goof up again?
Oh, you will. You will. We all will. We all goof up from time to time. That's part of being a normal human. But God is on our side. God will forgive you as long as you make a sincere effort to follow Him. He'll give you another chance.
And another. And another. And another.
All right, already. I get the point. So, how about a prayer, Pastor Rob?
Yeah, I think we can do that. Okay, let's pray together, shall we? God, we do mess up. We make mistakes. We know what you ask us to do. And Lord, sometimes, unintentionally, we choose the wrong thing. Sometimes, even knowing what we're doing, we still make bad choices. We thank you, Lord, that you give us a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance. We pray that you keep us on the path that you've called us to walk. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Rob. I think that's going to help.
Yeah. So you'll be here again next week, right, to get me out of trouble if I goof up again?
Right. But hopefully that won't be necessary. You're going to make good choices this week, I can tell.
Yeah, that's what we always do. See you, everybody.
Time will tell. All right. See you next week. Bye.
All right. You guys can go back to your seats, and we can all open our hymnals. You don't need to open your hymnals. The words will be on the screen. And we'll sing together hymn number 249, Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart, verses 1, 3, and 4. Sunday, and fact, we study in depth the Sunday morning scriptures on Wednesday night. So when you come on Sunday, you've already got a really good background of everything that's going on in these passages. So I do encourage you, as Adrian has already, to come out Wednesday evening at 6:30 over in the fellowship hall. And this Wednesday night, we'll study next Sunday's passages. In our gospel reading today, Jesus reads from the prophet Isaiah. As the story goes, he's back in his hometown synagogue. He comes up to the front. He unrolls the scroll of Isaiah, and he finds the place where it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor," or the year of Jubilee. And when Jesus finished reading this passage from Isaiah, he rolls the scroll back up, and he looks up at the congregation gathered before him, and he says, "Ta-da! Here I am!" Kind of, okay. What he says is, today the scripture has been fulfilled, which is to say, the good news that Isaiah proclaimed, it's happening right now. I'm here. I'm the one that Isaiah was talking about. Jesus doesn't come right out and say, "I am the Messiah," but he sure does imply it in our reading today. And this continues our theme of Epiphany. Epiphany means illumination, when God illuminates his presence in our lives. And in today's story, the divinity of Jesus is illuminated to the people gathered in that place of worship. They realize that they are face to face with Emmanuel, God with us. I don't know how we would respond. Imagine if somebody came on a Sunday when I'm not here, perhaps, a guest preacher, and read some Old Testament prophecy, something like from the book of Isaiah that tells us of the coming of the Messiah, and then looked out at you all, looked out at the congregation, and said, "Today the scripture has been fulfilled right here." I imagine that people wouldn't respond too kindly to that. I've read about people over history who have claimed to be the Messiah. It seems every 20 years or so, someone out in the world proclaims themselves to be the Messiah returned. It doesn't usually go well for them. And it didn't go well for Jesus either. His remarks there in the last verse of our gospel reading, they stir up a pretty emotional response, an angry response from the congregation. The people say, "What nerve do you have? How dare you proclaim to be the Messiah?" We'll get into that one next week. Today, I want to focus a little more on the words that Jesus read from Isaiah and to see if we can figure out why Jesus chose to read those words. Of all of the Old Testament writings that he had access to, why was it that particular reading? But first, we have to set the stage for this drama. One of the things we do on Wednesday night in Bible study, I ask everyone to use their mind's eye to imagine what the scene looks like. It's one thing to read the words, it's another to imagine how it looks. Today's scene depicts one of Jesus' first public acts of ministry. In the timeline of events, after Jesus is baptized, then he's called into the wilderness to be tempted for 40 days. Then he begins recruiting disciples, calling followers, students who will be his learners, his people who will learn his teachings and his way of life. And then these disciples are all with him at the wedding feast in Cana, where Jesus turns water into wine. Remember, that was last week's sermon. And then after that, having recovered from that rowdy wedding banquet in Cana, Jesus and his crew are now headed back to his hometown. Not the town he was born in, but the town he grew up in, the town of his childhood. The St. Louis area has a reputation for people always asking each other, "Where did you go to high school?" It seems that it doesn't really matter where you were born. We want to know, where did you grow up? Where were you educated? And that's Jesus' issue today. If he were to be asked that question, "Where did you go to high school?" he would say, "Nazareth." Not the place of his birth, but Nazareth. And that's where our gospel reading picks up the story. Jesus is filled with the Holy Spirit and charged up, ready to go, and he returns back to his homeland, back in Galilee, his old stomping grounds. And it doesn't take long for word to spread. Word travels quickly in those small towns. People are already talking. He did what at that wedding? How much wine? The reputation begins to grow. Luke says it plainly in our gospel reading today. A report about Jesus spread all through the countryside. And Jesus finds himself doing some guest preaching and teaching in all of the region's synagogues. He would visit and he would say a few words. And he was pretty consistently met with accolades. People were really astounded by what he had to say. It seems that Jesus was a very well-liked and very popular teacher. And then he goes to Nazareth, where he grew up, back to the synagogue, where he would have been as a child, as a teenager. This was on the Sabbath day. This was his custom. On Sabbath day, you go to worship. On Sunday, you go to church, because that's what we do, right? And the arrangement of a Jewish synagogue is not really that unlike the way we set up our churches. There's congregational seating for everyone to sit. There's some kind of an elevated platform. We call this a chancel. That's the actual word for this platform here. And there's a place for the teacher to read the text. And they don't call rabbis preachers, interestingly. Preaching, that word is a Greek word that comes from the New Testament. The teacher, the rabbi, would teach the text, not preach it. Worship leaders would sing songs and lead prayers, and then the rabbi would stand behind a podium and read the scripture reading for the day. And after the reading, the rabbi would sit on a chair in front of the congregation to reflect and to offer his thoughts on the text, to teach the text. And if you're curious how long these rabbis' talks could last, keep in mind that they were sitting on a chair. So there was no physical reminder that it's time to start wrapping it up. The order of worship remains pretty much the same when Jesus visits his hometown synagogue in Nazareth. Jesus is widely accepted all across the area as a remarkably insightful, up-and-coming rabbi. People wanted to hear what he had to say. So he's been invited to sit alongside his hometown rabbi. It would be customary, of course, when a visiting rabbi comes, to allow the visiting rabbi to lead the teaching for the day. Someone hands Jesus the scroll of Isaiah. He unscrolls it, looks through it. He finds this particular passage that he wants, the passage we hear in our gospel reading today. And that's the story. It's an interesting passage that Jesus chooses to read. In this scene recorded in Luke's gospel, Jesus is referencing Isaiah's prophecy regarding, among other things, the year of the Lord's favor. That's also called the year of Jubilee. Jubilee is one of those Old Testament words that pops up from time to time in our hymns or in our Bible studies. But you know, most people don't really know what the year of Jubilee is. For those who do know, you either love the idea or you're utterly terrified by it. It's a pretty extreme commandment. It's a commandment that never has actually been implemented. So here's the Jubilee commandment. In the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament, God gives to Moses the law by which God's people are to live and abide. That's not news for us. We know that. And within these laws, we have instructions regarding all sorts of things, like the forgiveness of debts. That's what Jubilee refers to. Every seventh year was to be called a Sabbath year or a sabbatical, a year during which no interest was to be collected on any loans. Wouldn't that be nice? When you pay your mortgage every seventh year, there's no interest to be collected. It's nice if you're the one paying the loan. It's not favored by those who hold the loans. After seven cycles of this, or in other words, the 50th year, that was called the year of Jubilee, or the year of the Lord's favor. And on that year, the 50th year, all debts were to be canceled, no matter how big, no matter how small. That means if you take out a car note on the 49th year, year 50, it's wiped clean. Wouldn't that be nice? Buy a house on the 49th year. The 50th year, no more debt. It's wiped out. All of the land that had been foreclosed upon would automatically revert back to its original owners. This was an act of praise to God's provision. Imagine if your family had to sell everything to pay off debts and you still ended up owing money. After 50 years of crushing debt, it would be like God pushing the reset button. Everybody starts over again with a blank slate. That's the year of Jubilee. Honestly, this would be fantastic for the poor. You can understand why those who are indebted would love this notion. For those families that had been in debt from generation to generation, but what about for those families that had done well? What about for the bankers and the brokers, the people who held all of those liens on those debts? Obviously, they would have hated this notion of a year of Jubilee, resetting the clock, forgiving debts, returning land, redistributing everything back to where it had begun. This would have been a nightmare for the wealthy people. And since it's often the wealthy people who have the most influence in government, you can imagine why the year of Jubilee never actually went into practice, even though God commanded it. Jubilee isn't just about redistribution of wealth. The year of Jubilee, or the year of the Lord's favor, was a massive cultural reset button too. Was a huge do-over for the entire population. Imagine if, of all the decisions you've made in life, you were given an opportunity to step away from those and have a complete redo, a do-over. Prison doors would be thrown open. All the captives would be set free, given another chance. It didn't matter if you were serving 6 months for larceny or 60 to life for murder. Jubilee is God's way of giving each generation one opportunity for a second chance at life. Again, this would be great news for the prisoners. And again, you can see why a lot of people were very opposed to this idea of Jubilee. Servants or slaves, those who were especially oppressed by an economy that was built on slavery, on sweat equity, they were to be released. Those who just couldn't see any future ahead of them, those who were blind to any form of hope because they never felt like they could get ahead economically, they were given the opportunity to see. They were being given liberation, and that's the theme of Jubilee. It's liberation. Everything gets reset. It's starting over again, which is indeed good news for the poor, good news for the captive, good news for the blind and the oppressed. That's what Jesus reads from Isaiah in our reading today. You might imagine that this would have been strongly opposed, though, by the wealthy, by the lien holders, the landowners, the victims of crime, as the prosecuted are in prison. Imagine the victims feeling when the prison doors were to be opened and everybody set free. This is not, perhaps, good news for everybody. So that's the question. Is the year of the Lord's favor, is Jubilee, is this really good news? Kind of depends on how the last 50 years have gone for you and your family. Some would welcome this reset. Some would look forward to it. Others would feel very threatened by it. The poor would love to have their debts paid off, no doubt. But like I said, what about those who had worked hard to pay off their debts and even had saved up some money? That's just not fair, right? You see, we humans, we have a long, well-documented history of struggling with what God actually asks us to do. This was the case in Isaiah's day, and it was the case in Jesus' day. For a variety of reasons, the year of Jubilee, this commandment of the Lord, was never actually observed by the Israelites. They just kind of overlooked that. But Jesus, in his teaching that day in the synagogue, indicates that he was the fulfillment of these scriptures. Scriptures that day were about Jubilee. In other words, what Jesus is saying is, no matter how well off or wealthy you are, no matter how poor or destitute you are, no matter if you were in prison for some heinous crime, or maybe you have never had so much as a parking ticket, no matter if you had 30 servants and slaves working your land, or if you were the servant who worked your own land, the good news of God's word is that we are all equals before God. No one is any better or any worse in God's eyes. No single person has any right to look down upon another when we stand before God. Class status, the way we separate ourselves into groups, that's something that we humans created for ourselves. That's not how it works with God. And the year of Jubilee is a reminder of this. I mentioned that the crowd had a pretty animated reaction to Jesus' teaching, and I will talk more about that next week. But I wonder this morning how I'm feeling about this teaching, about this year of Jubilee. I imagine the implications of a Jubilee year, a year of the Lord's favor, would be about the same today as it was in Jesus' day. I suspect if Jesus today insisted that we honor or practice a year of Jubilee, a lot of people would be lifted out of otherwise inescapable debt. A lot of people would be given a clean slate and a second chance that they never imagined would come. And for the first and only time in their lives, they could actually begin to get ahead. Of course, a lot of people would say, hey, wait a minute, I've worked my tail off to earn a living, to pay my debts. Why should they get a free ride? But see, this is how it works with God. Later in his ministry, Jesus teaches the parable of the vineyard, sometimes called the parable of the servants. And maybe you remember this parable. The owner of the vineyard goes out early in the morning to hire helpers for the day. And he says to them, I will pay you a day's wage to come work for me today. And they do. And then he goes out at lunchtime and he hires some more workers. And he says to these guys, I will pay you a day's wage to come work for me. And they do. And then he goes out a couple hours just before quitting time and he hires more workers. And he says to these guys too, I will pay you a day's wage to work for me. And they do. And at the end of the day, when the payroll is distributed, total pandemonium breaks out, as you can imagine. Technically, nobody got cheated out of money. They all got exactly what each had agreed to work for. But obviously, the workers who started work in the morning were furious that the latecomers were getting the same amount of pay. That just doesn't seem fair, does it? This Jubilee-themed teaching was common for Jesus. Not really surprised that this is how he began his preaching career. What I am surprised about is that we're still struggling with this concept, with this good news that in God's eyes, we are all equal. It doesn't matter if we come to faith as children and live faithful, obedient lives until the day we die, or if we come to Christ at the last possible moment. The promise, the good news, is the same for all of us. It almost seems like we're the ones who want to keep people down because they haven't lived lives of the same worthiness we have in our hearts. That's how we feel. It almost seems like we too would reject God's commandment for Jubilee because it just doesn't seem fair using our sense of logic. And I suppose people still respond to this idea of Jubilee the same way as they did in Jesus' day. There will always be poor. There will always be oppressed who hear the good news of liberation with great hope and anticipation. How many times in Scripture do we read that Jesus will set the captives free? That sounds wonderful to all of the prisoners who are currently locked up. That doesn't sound very good to some of us, though. And there are always going to be those social advocates, those people who realize how unfair the world really is to the poor and the oppressed and the prisoners, and they too hear these words of Jubilee with anticipation in their hearts. And then there are those of us who get very angry at the idea of it all. This is how it is with Jesus' teachings. There are those who embrace them. There are those of us who wrestle and struggle with them. That's the challenge for us in our day. If we want to proclaim ourselves God's people, people of God's word, then that means we actually have to allow ourselves to be shaped by God's word. That means we have to allow ourselves, like the potter's clay, to be molded and formed. So often we try to mold and form God's word into what we want it to say. But as people of God's word, we have to let it deal with us. Like a pencil sharpener cuts away at the end of a pencil, we have to allow God's word to shape us, to carve us, to bring us to the point that God wants us to be at. Not only to guide and lead us, but to shape our thoughts, to shape the way we think, to see people in the world as God sees us. That's what God's word challenges us to do. Sometimes this requires a great deal of sharpening and molding and reforming and shaping, especially for those of us with strong opinions. Strong opinions are like stones. They too can be carved and shaped. It just takes a little more effort. Through Jesus, God shows us a different way of living and a different way of thinking, vastly different than the way the world around us works. Jesus shows us the concept of Jubilee, a world that is built on forgiveness, clemency, amnesty and mercy. And if we are followers of Jesus, we're invited not just to read or proclaim these words, but to actually live by them, to live in a life built on forgiveness, clemency, amnesty, and mercy. And so my prayer today is, may God give us the courage and the faith to allow ourselves to be truly transformed, to be shaped by God's word. May we come to believe that this concept of jubilee is the way of life God leads us to live. Amen.
Amen.
Will you pray with me? Lord, it's tempting for us to hold mistakes against people, to hold debts over people, to hold crimes committed against those who are imprisoned, to hold oppression accountable for mistakes. It's easy for us to look at those who have not achieved in life and point out all the reasons that they have messed it up for themselves. But you, Lord, teach us a different way. In you, Lord, we find our joy. In you, we find your law, your prophets, instructing us to live a life of mercy, a life of righteousness. Pour out your Spirit on us today, Lord, that we who are Christ's body, that we may bear the good news of your ancient promise, that we also might proclaim the release of the captives, the forgiveness of debts, that this extreme way of life, built on mercy and compassion, might be our way of life as your people. We pray that you continue to shape and mold us into the people you've called us to be. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. If you would stand with me as you're comfortably able, we'll sing together hymn number 259, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. We're singing verses 1, 2, and 3. Favor is now. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.